Well, my sermon today is the way God turns old news into good news. And I want to remind everyone that Advent is a season where we take these readings from the Bible. I follow the lectionary schedule. And this is not only a time to prepare for Christmas, it's a season like Lent where we take a look at the whole Bible and especially the Gospels and reintroduce ourselves or familiarize ourselves with all these parts of the story of Jesus Christ in the Gospels. Today we're reading from Mark's Gospel, and Mark's Gospel is quite different. If you look at Matthew and Luke, especially during Advent, those are the Gospels that contain texts about the genealogy and ancestry of Jesus. They tell the story of Mary and Joseph and the Holy Family and the birth of Jesus, the shepherds and the wise men. But none of that is found in Mark's Gospel. In fact, the text that we read today, the very first chapter, the first 8 verses, the Gospel opens at the River Jordan with John the Baptist and Jesus. The first of the verse of the text is the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. You ever wondered what that means? The good news of Jesus Christ. The good news. Well, we have to remember that in the Bible there's often many layers of meaning. And then sometimes we just look at what it means to us. And I think for most of you, they would say, well, the good news of Jesus, the gospel, the good news is that Christ came to save me. He died for my sins. I can go to heaven because I'm forgiven, and so on and so forth. Most of our opinion of our faith is about ourselves and about how we look at what the good news is for me. But this is not what Mark was thinking about when he wrote the first chapter of the Gospel of Mark. He was thinking of a much bigger picture. He was thinking in historical world terms. And one of the reasons why we know that is if we look at the original Greek, the word for good news is euangelion. Eu is in euphoria, angelos. Angelon means message, good message. And we can see that if we look at ancient texts and books about Greek, that good news, the euangelion, was usually a very big political event or some type of important news event or announcement about a king, about Caesar, about an emperor. And that's what Mark is saying here. Now, how can we understand that? Let's think of days of good news that were a big event in the world. Maybe some of you can remember the end of World War II and VE Day, which was May 8th, 1945. If you look at the old pictures from newspapers or on the internet, you'll see huge crowds celebrating and people rejoicing about the good news that the war was over and that the German enemy had unconditionally surrendered and the war in Europe was over. That's what Mark was thinking about. That magnitude of good news that affected many people. And in short, we could say the good news was also about a king. The king who would come to lead us into the kingdom of God. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't think I've ever seen a holiday or Christmas card, or any card for that matter, that has John the Baptist. Have you? So it does seem a little strange that we're talking about John the Baptist at Christmas and Advent. But as I said, our purpose is to see the broader picture of the gospel and understand the significance of Jesus Christ so that when we arrive at Christmas, we can have a deep gratitude for who he is and what he does for us. The second verse goes on to say, "See, I am sending ahead of you a messenger. See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you who will prepare the way." And this is a quote from the prophet Isaiah. Now, I want to take a moment and talk about John the Baptist. He is one of the most interesting characters in the Bible. There's certain people that stand at turning points in history and are witnesses and participants in a major change in world history, and that's who John the Baptist is. And sometimes we think of him in stereotypical terms, as the man who wore a coat made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, eating locusts and wild honey, wandering in the wilderness. But John came from a very prestigious priestly family. His father, Zechariah, was a priest. So he was a religious blue blood, in a matter of speaking. And the way he bridges the old and the new, the old and the New Testament, is with these words of the prophet Isaiah. Now, John's life is fascinating. John's birth, like Jesus, was miraculous. His mother, who was advanced in age, could not conceive children, and was told by God that she would conceive a child. And his miraculous birth occurred in her older, later years. And what we see as we look in the Bible, we can see this is actually not even a new pattern. When we go back to Genesis and we look at the story of the original patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, we will see that Abraham and Sarah were in the same position, that Sarah was advanced in age and could not bear children. And God blessed her, and she had the son Isaac. And this began a whole new lineage that would become the lineage of the family of Israel. So John's birth with the mother who was advanced in age and barren parallels Sarah and Isaac in the Old Testament and shows God's miraculous starting of a new line, a new lineage of faith in the New Testament. The other interesting thing is this, is that when Mary was in her first trimester of pregnancy with Jesus, the first 3 months, she went and visited her cousin, Elizabeth. Yes, that's the same Elizabeth who is the mother of John. And while Elizabeth was further along, probably in her third trimester at the end of her pregnancy, the scriptures tell us that when she met Mary, it says, when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child in her womb leapt. The child, John the Baptist, leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. So we can see here that John and Jesus, although they were meeting at the River Jordan, and they're probably in their early 30s, they had actually first become acquainted even before they were born, and they were connected through family, through history, and through the Holy Spirit. But I also have to talk about the location where John was baptizing Jesus. If we go back in the Old Testament, one of the most important events in the history of Israel was when they crossed over into the Promised Land. And what did they cross over? They crossed over the Jordan River to Canaan. So it's interesting that God has chosen this place for a new crossing over of the people of God. Instead of crossing over to the Promised Land of Canaan, this is Jesus, the new Joshua, giving people the opportunity to cross over into the new Promised Land of the Kingdom of God. In fact, Jesus' name, Jesus, in Greek, comes from the Hebrew Yeshua, which means Joshua. So he is literally, by name, a new Joshua. It's amazing when we look at all these events and how they connect together from the Old and New Testament. Now, I have a story about that. When I went to seminary at Princeton, I used to go to the library and see an elderly man in his 90s sitting under a portrait of himself. And someone told me that that was Bruce Metzger, one of the greatest New Testament scholars of the 20th century, the chair of the translation committee of the Revised Standard Version of the Bible. And I thought, wow, this may be my only chance to ask a question to a really great biblical scholar. So I went over to Professor Metzger and I introduced myself. And I said, I have a question for you, sir, because you have been studying the Bible for how long? He said, well, over 60 years. I said, let me ask you this. Do you really believe that the Bible is the divinely inspired word of God? And this is a man who spent his whole life studying the Bible. And this is what he told me. He said, every time I study the Bible, I believe even more that this is the inspired word of God. Because I've studied tens of thousands of words in original languages and studied the history and the plot of the story of God in the Old and New Testament, and it all fits together like a puzzle so perfectly that the only way that that could have happened is there must have been a God that has orchestrated that, and that that God has revealed to the writers of the Bible those pieces and how they fit together. That was a good answer to the question, not by just someone who felt like it was the Word of God, the inspired Word of God, but someone who was a scholar, world-renowned. And I thought later about one of my favorite Bible verses that we actually read in today's text from Isaiah, and this is from verse 8 in chapter 40. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the Word of our God will stand forever. Let me repeat that. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the Word of our God will stand forever. And you see, because the Bible is God's Word, God's divinely inspired Word, we can turn to it, like today in this service, or any time that we read it, and it's like having direct access to communication from our God. Well, let's get back to John the Baptist. He did play a much bigger role in the story as he became a man and met Jesus and baptized him. And there were other events later that we won't discuss today. But he was considered to be the last of the Old Testament prophets. Now, the Old Testament prophets were spokespeople for God. When God had an important message, he would call a prophet like Jeremiah or Isaiah and give them a message and tell the people, this is important. You need to listen to this news, this good news. You need to hear God and what he's telling you. And that's exactly what John the Baptist was doing. But this was the end of the Old Testament and the beginning of the New Testament with Jesus. He starts by building a bridge between the Old Testament and the New Testament using a quote from Isaiah. That quote, which is, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way," those words were written 700 years earlier. So we are seeing a connection that spans 700 years of history and fulfills a prophecy. And this is one of those connections that I think Professor Metzger would have pointed to as evidence of how there's this masterful linking of events and words in the Bible that could only have been orchestrated by God. In short, what Mark was talking about here and showing is that John the Baptist was sent to play this role to say that the prophecy has been fulfilled, a prophecy over 700 years old, that the Messiah has come. And this Messiah, this Savior, will be the King who will lead you into the kingdom, the new promised land. And you need to repent. You need to turn away from your human ways and turn to God and follow the Savior who will show you the way. Well, I have another story about a coworker. And a number of years ago, there was a coworker who really liked to help people, maybe to the point of a fault, trying to get in everyone's business and fix everything. And she would get frustrated. And one time she came to me and she said, "You know, I'm not religious, Howard, but I need to talk about this. It's bothering me." And she asked me what I thought. And I said, "Well, I can give you a simple answer. There is a Savior, and you're not him." And she laughed, and I said, "If we don't believe in God and God's help, then we try to step in and control things in our life, and there's no room left for God." And this is, in a sense, what John the Baptist was doing. You see, John was recognized as a prophet, and people came from all over Jerusalem and Judea to hear him preach. Some even thought that he was the Messiah. And one of the most important things he said is that, "I don't want you to believe that I'm the Messiah. I am just the messenger." And he said in verses 7 through 8, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thongs of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. John was saying, there is a Savior, and I'm not him. You need to turn to him. And what we see from this text are these points. That we are meant to focus on Jesus Christ as our Savior. I know that term is constantly repeated in the church, but we have to understand what that means. And in our daily lives right now, we need someone to save us. To save us from the virus of this pandemic. Someone that can save us from our despair, our frustration, our hopelessness. Yes, if we're believers, we believe we're saved and we can go to heaven. But what do we do until then? We need someone to intervene and to save us and lead us into the kingdom of God, which is a relationship with God, where we can deal with life's challenges. Now that's on an individual level. Now if you're like me and someone who likes to think about the big picture, look at the time we're living in right now. This global pandemic is on a historical magnitude of something like World War II or the Civil War or great wars in Europe. It's big. It's a big problem. It's going to change history. It already has. And one of the things that we get from the Bible is that God is a God of history that intervenes during historical times when we need him. He not only sees the small picture of our lives and our struggling, but he sees the big picture too, and he will provide a way for us to get through this, whether it's empowering scientists to come up with vaccines, or whether it's helping our leaders make wise decisions to lead us through the difficult time, but God will intervene. And what Advent is our time to reflect upon who that Savior is, so that we appreciate him, and so that we turn from our old ways to new ways, to the new way of following the King into the kingdom of God. So to summarize, what we have from the text today is that God continues to love us. And he not only loves us, but he provides means of salvation and helping us during difficult historical times like this. God knows that when we feel disappointed, when we are disappointed by depending on human beings that let us down, that this is not the end. It's not the end of the story like the two barren women that we talked about. Sometimes the ending is a new beginning. And this is where we need to realize that we have to shift our focus and place our faith not in just human salvation and help, but in divine help through God. And then finally, John does say at the end of the text that I am baptizing you with water, and he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. And that's so important, that we have to remember that as we get through this difficult time, we have to turn to the Holy Spirit, who is called the Counselor, the Comforter, and that will sustain us and get us through this difficult time. One of the main themes throughout Scripture is that God takes the old things and the old news, and he turns them into new life. New life in Jesus Christ as we contemplate the Christmas and Advent season. And if we take our old news, the old news of sickness and frustration and disappointment, if we take that old news and we take it to God and turn to Christ, God can turn old news into good news when we look to him to be the source of our help and salvation. Well, we light Advent candles during Advent. I don't have them here with me today, but as we light candles, this is a season where we use the symbolism of light overcoming darkness, of the Savior coming. And I wanted to end with scripture from the first chapter of John's Gospel that summarizes the frame of mind that we need to have as we have God help us turn old news into good news. What has come into being in Jesus is life, and his life is the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness will not overcome it. Amen.